Out the holly, put up the tree before my spirit falls again. Fill up the stocking, I may be rushing things, but deck the halls again now.
Hello to everyone at the fountains. My name is Dr. Marguerite Millet, and I'm going to be talking about Mame, the music, a bit about the story, a little bit of gossip as well. We're going to get right to it because there's a lot to unpack in this movie and lots of good music. Mame is a very well-known musical with the book by Jerome Lawrence and Robert Edwin Lee, music and lyrics by Jerry Herman. It's based on the 1955 novel Anti-Mame, An Irreverent Escapade by Patrick Dennis, which is a pseudonym for the writer Edward Everett Tanner. The novel was one of the best-selling books of the 20th century. It set records on the New York Times bestseller list with over 2 million copies during its first printing alone. Some have thought that the book had been inspired by Dennis's real-life eccentric aunt, Marion Tanner, whose life and outlook resembled those of Mame, but Dennis denied the connection. The story takes place in New York City over the course of the Great Depression and World War II. It's about a rather eccentric bohemian, Mame Dennis, who lives an over-the-top life with her wealthy friends. But this is interrupted when her recently orphaned nephew, the son of her brother, arrives to live with her. The first stage adaptation was also by Jerome Lawrence and Robert Lee. That Broadway production was not a musical, and it was called Anti-Mame, same as the book. It starred Rosalind Russell as Mame and Peggy Cass as Agnes Gooch. Both Russell and Cass were nominated for Tony Awards, and Cass won the award. The play ran from 1956 to 1958. In December 1958, Warner Brothers released a film, same title, Anti-Mame, and again, not a musical, with Russell and Cass in their same roles. They were both nominated for an Academy Award. In addition, Russell won a Golden Globe. In 1966, the musical version opened on Broadway. It starred Angela Lansbury as Mame and B. Arthur as Vera Charles, and was simply called Mame. The musical was inspired by the success of previous stage and screen versions. Since both were so well received, it seemed logical to turn the story into a musical. The author of the original novel, Patrick Dennis, had written several more comic novels, including Little Me, which was made into a Broadway musical starring Sid Caesar. The success of that musical probably also helped to convince Lawrence and Lee to turn Mame into a musical. A little backstage gossip. The directors had originally wanted Mary Martin in the title role, but she turned it down. The part went to Angela Lansbury. Also, for its second run, Jerry Herman, the composer, wanted to cast Judy Garland, but that was turned down by the producers of the show. They felt she was a liability based on her unreliability on other projects. The musical opened on Broadway in 1966 and ran until 1970. And Angela Lansbury and Bea Arthur both won Tony Awards for their performances. The 1969 West End production in London starred Ginger Rogers and ran for 14 months with a special performance for Queen Elizabeth II. A cast recording of the Broadway production was released in 1966. 30 years later, 1999, a CD version with 5 bonus tracks was released by Legacy Recordings. We'll be listening to the examples from that CD today. The bonus tracks are really interesting. They include demo versions, all performed by the composer, Jerry Herman, and Alice Borden, and he's just playing the piano. We will hear one of them just to contrast. It's really kind of interesting. In 1966, Louis Armstrong had a smash hit with his recording of Mame, the title song. Edie Gourmet had a huge success, with her recording of If He Walked Into My Life. In fact, that earned her a Grammy Award. for the Best Female Vocal Performance in 1967. And of course, We Need a Little Christmas is now a very well-known holiday song. In 1974, the musical was made into a film of the same title starring Lucille Ball as Mame, Bea Arthur repeating her stage role as Vera, and Robert Preston. This film did not do well at the box office, although it did break attendance records at Radio City Music Hall. And there were mixed reviews, which I will talk about later. So, let's get into the story and listen to some examples of the music. Mame's brother has passed away, and the trustee, Mr. Babcock, has revealed that the brother's young son, Patrick Dennis, is to be left in the care of his aunt, Mame Dennis, as well as his nanny, Agnes Gooch. They take a train to New York City and are looking for Beekman Place, a place they think will be a haven from all the sinfulness of the city. They imagine Mame, Aunt Mame, as being very, very maternal, baking a cherry pie, glazing a ham, and offering a very quiet home. Agnes and Patrick arrive at Mame's home at Beekman Place, and they walk into a wild party that Mame is giving. She explains she's giving the party not for any special occasion, but simply because it's today. So what I'm going to do is first play for you a little bit of the demo with the composer Jerry Herman playing piano and singing.
Pass the peanuts, get the ice out, roll the rug up, it's today. Though it may not be anyone's birthday, and though it's far from the first of the year, I know that this very minute has history in it, we're here. Time for making merry, and so I'm for making hay. Tune the grand up, dance your shoes off, strike the band up, it's today.
All right, and now we'll hear how it came out with Angela Lansbury.
strike the band up. It's today.
And we're living, and we're well.
Okay, so Mame introduces Patrick to her friends, which includes a very famous stage actress and famous lush, Vera Charles. Patrick finds out right away about his aunt's rather unconventional lifestyle in the glitzy New York of the Jazz Age and her very different way of being. In fact, there's a line from the novel that describes the party, quote, "They all used funny words like batik and Freud and inferiority complex and abstraction." So this is a different kind of crowd. Well, Mame decides that she wants to fill the child's life with adventure. And she sings, "Open a New Window."
Open a new window, open a new door, travel a new highway that's never been tried before. Before you find you're a dull fellow, punching the same clock, walking the same tightrope as everyone on the block. The fella you want to be is three-dimensional, soaking up life down to your toes. Whenever they say you're slightly unconventional, just put your thumb up to your nose and show them how to dance to a new rhythm, whistle a new song, toast with a new vintage. The fizz doesn't fizz too long. There's only one way to make the bubble stay. Simply travel a new highway, dance to a new rhythm, open a new window every day. If you follow your Auntie Mame, I'll make this vow, my little love, that on the last day of your life, you'll be smiling the same young smile. You're smiling now, my little love. If you wake up every morning and you pull aside the shutter and you promise me that these will be the first words that you utter. Open a new window. Open a new door, travel a new highway that's never been tried before.
So, Patrick soon becomes accustomed to his aunt's sleeping habits, where 9 a.m. is the middle of the night, her glamorous theater friends, and all the fads and crazes that Mame tries. She enrolls him in the School of Life, a very experimental and controversial school. But when Vera leads the trustee Babcock to the school by mistake, the furious trustee takes Patrick from Mame's custody and enrolls him in boarding school. That's pretty bad. But then the 1929 stock market crash leaves Mame penniless. Vera offers her a small role, as the man in the moon in her newest operetta about a lady astronomer. So now we're going to hear B. Arthur singing The Man in the Moon.
Oh, Vera, I can't wait to hear that overture. Tell me about the show.
Well, it's this terribly modern operetta about a lady astronomer who makes a universe-shaking discovery. Shocking, it's completely true. I know it isn't God. gossip or rumor, of course, for I've had it from quite a reliable source, and I'd like to pass it on to you. I think it's just one of the girls. She winks at the stars from her bed of green cheese. That isn't a nightgown, it's a Saturn chemise. Oh, her friends are the stars.
Mame has one line in this play, and she flubs it, and it ended up causing the play to be a disaster, and that definitely affects the friendship with Vera. Patrick, who happened to be in the audience, reassures Mame afterwards that he still loves her with this song, My Best Girl. Not going to be an actress, but she still needs money. So she works a string of jobs and kind of failing at all of them. One is in a department store where she meets Beauregard, Jackson, Pickett, Burnside and tries to sell him a pair of roller skates. Unfortunately, she can't write up a cash order and she's fired from yet another job. Mame goes home very upset that she's unable to pay her servant or Agnes Gooch, who've loyally stayed with her. So Mame decides to lift everyone's spirits by decorating the house for Christmas and giving everyone their Christmas gifts early. And now we'll hear We Need a Little Christmas.
The holly, put up the tree before my spirit falls again. Fill up the stocking, I may be rushing things, but deck the halls again now. For we need a little Christmas right this very minute. Candles in the window, carols at the spirit. Yes, we need a little Christmas right this very minute. It hasn't snowed a single flurry, but
we're in a hurry, so climb down the chimney, put up the brightest string of lights I've ever seen. Slice up the fruitcake, it's time we hung some tinsel on that evergreen bough. For I've grown a little leaner, grown a little colder, grown a little sadder, grown a little older, and I need a little angel sitting on my shoulder, need a little Christmas now.
So they give their gifts to each other. One of the gifts is for Patrick, his first pair of long pants. And Agnes and her servants surprise her with the news that the butcher bill has been paid. In the meantime, Beauregard Jackson Pickett Burnside has been looking for Mame since she was fired, and he appears at her door and invites everyone to dinner. Beau falls in love and brings Mame and Patrick to his family's plantation in Peckerwood, Georgia, where they're greeted rather coolly. A number of Beau's relatives, especially Mother Burnside and Cousin Fan, are very unhappy about Beau marrying a Yankee. Mame is then invited to a fox hunt. Despite not knowing anything about riding a horse, Mame accepts. After a wild ride, Mame accidentally captures the fox. At this point, most of Beau's family and friends now sing her praises.
Dixie back to Dixieland. You make the cotton easy to pick. Rain, you give my old mint julep a kick. Rain, who ever thought a Yankee would put a little Dixie bells to shame?
On an extended honeymoon traveling all over the world. Now, while they're away, remember, Patrick is in boarding school. So he goes from a B-plus average student, some years go by, to a failing high school senior. This is captured in this next song, which has the younger Patrick writing a letter in the first half and the older Patrick writing a very different letter in the second half.
In English lit, I'm in the top 10. I got a B-plus average again. Tahiti sounds the greatest of all the crazy places that you've been. Wait till you hear the latest. I think I've got a whisker on my chin.
Dear Auntie Mae, I find it's getting harder to cram. I flunked my Latin grammar exam. I'm shaving every morning and growing like it's going out of style. The debts all seem to go for me. Give France a big hello for me. hug to Uncle Bob for me. Your loving nephew, Patrick.
Whoops. Okay. Well, bad news. Bo dies in an avalanche in the Alps. Mame returns home to be reunited with a now-grown Patrick, who is dating a snobby, conservative girl named Gloria Upson. Mame meets Vera for a drink, and the two trade snippy comments, which they insist they're not being nasty, they're just being honest, because that's what bosom buddies do.
Always be bosom buddies, friends, sisters, and pals. We'll always be bosom buddies. If life should reject you, there's me to protect you. If I say that your tongue is vicious, it's simply that. Who else but a bosom buddy? Though now and again I'm aware that my candid opinion may sting. If I kept my hair natural like yours, I'd be bald.
So the two of them come home, and they start to reminisce about all the men that they've dated. Agnes Gooch, remember her? Well, she's still hanging around. Anyway, she listens to the conversation and admits that she's never had a date. Mame and Vera decide to give the uptight, kind of frumpy Agnes a makeover and send her out to live her life. 6 months later, Agnes returns home, visibly pregnant. Agnes then describes what she did while living it up.
With my wings resolutely spread, Mrs. Burnside, and my old inhibitions shed, Mrs. Burnside, I did each little thing you said, Mrs. Burnside, I lived, I lived.
That's Agnes Gooch at this point. Mame visits Patrick's girlfriend's Gloria's family, the Upsons, at their home in Connecticut, which is called Ups and Downs. Get it? She learns for the first time that Patrick and Gloria are engaged. After spending several hours with the Upsons, she finds them to be boring, and on top of that, they are bigots. Mame is asked to help pay for a piece of property next door to Ups and Downs so that Patrick and Gloria could live there, as opposed to the wrong kind of people. Afterward, she is honest with Patrick about her feelings about the family. She doesn't like them. In return, he tells Mame that he's ashamed of her and all of her crazy friends. A heartbroken Mame wonders what she did wrong with this boy who had been placed in her care. She sings, "If he walked into my life." Patrick are in Mame's home, and they apologize to each other. They're dressed for company. The Upsons are coming to visit. Mame promises to behave, and Patrick meets Mame's new maid, Pegene. Remember that. Mr. and Mrs. Upson announce that the property they'd wanted had been bought by some lawyer, and they use a racial slur to describe this lawyer. Vera and several men suddenly barge into Mame's house, singing It's Today, the song from the beginning of the movie. Vera mistakenly thinks Pegene is Patrick's fiancée Gloria and toasts the new couple. At that moment, an obviously pregnant Agnes comes downstairs, and the Upsons discover she's not married, and they're shocked. Then a busload of other unwed pregnant women arrives, singing Open a New Window, again that song that we heard from earlier. Mame reveals to the Upsons that she bought the property next door so she could build the Beauregard Burnside Memorial Home for Single Mothers. The Upsons leave in a huff, furious that Mame isn't one of us. Patrick is very upset and also leaves. Okay, so then fast forward, a lot of stuff happens that we don't see. And now it's years later. following World War II, and a lot has happened. Patrick ended up marrying Pegeen, the maid, and they have a child named Peter. Mame is going on a trip to Siberia and asks that Peter be allowed to go with her. Although Patrick and Pegeen have some doubts, they eventually relent. Mame and Peter get onto a plane, and Patrick states that Mame has not changed and that she's the Pied Piper. Mame and Peter wave goodbye, go into the plane, and the plane takes off. And then we hear the music again, Open a New Window, and the theme song, Mame. So that is the story. Now I'm going to tell you a little bit about the movie, because it was kind of controversial. Filming, first of all, had been scheduled to begin in early 1972, but was postponed when Lucille Ball broke her leg in a skiing accident. Because of the delay, the original director, George Cukor, had to withdraw from the project. He was replaced by Gene Sachs, who had directed the original non-musical Broadway production. Filming began in January 1973. Madeline Kahn had been cast as Agnes Gooch, but Lucille Ball, who had casting approval, did not like her interpretation of the role and had her replaced by Jane Connell, another member of the original Broadway cast. For some reason, Warner Brothers executives passed over Angela Lansbury for the title role, even though, remember, she won a Tony for that performance for her role on Broadway. Radio City Music Hall selected the film to be its Easter attraction, and as I mentioned earlier, it broke attendance records there. However, overall, the film did not do well at the box office, and there were some brutal reviews, especially those for Lucille Ball. One critic wrote, quote, "Each time we see Miss Ball in close-up, it appears as if the camera lens has been smeared with Vaseline. Someone should have told Miss Ball that her public cares not about her face, but rather what's behind it. The very essence of the Mame character, as I understand it, is that she's able to stare old age in the face and make it slink away. And she does this not with makeup, but with her personality." Unquote. There were also some snarky comments about her singing. In her defense, Lucille Ball told one interviewer, "Mame stayed up all night and drank champagne. What do you expect her to sound like, Julie Andrews?" And not all the reviews were bad. Vincent Canby in the New York Times, for example, while expressing great reservations about the film and the famous close-ups of Lucille Ball, wrote that the film is, quote, "as determined to please in its way as Mame is in hers," unquote. Judith Crist wrote, "Lucille Ball is a first-rate entertainer, supplementing her superb comedic sense with a penetrating warmth and inner humor," unquote. Both Lucille Ball and Bea Arthur received Golden Globe nominations, but Lucille Ball was very hurt by the film's reception, and she swore she would never appear in a film again. Bea Arthur later called her involvement with the film a tremendous embarrassment and expressed regret at having participated. Although she enjoyed working with Lucille Ball, she made no secret of her opinion that Lucy was terribly miscast. So there's a lot to think about in watching this movie, and I'm curious to know your responses. So please feel free to give feedback to Lisa, Donna, or anyone from Community Life about the movie. So, it's been a long road as we enter into our 11th month of lockdown. I look forward to the future, and I look forward to seeing you all again in person, and hopefully very soon. Take care and be well. Thank you.